So hello, and thank you very much for joining us. So as you see, of course, we're looking at assessments to help teach your young learners throughout the year. And just to introduce ourselves before we get started, my name is Sarah Ellis, and I work in the assessment services team, and I'm based in Italy. And I'm here today with...
My name is Michael Abberton. I'm a senior assessment manager working in the Young Learners Content Team, and I'm based in Cambridge.
Absolutely. So thank you very much. So thank you again for joining us, and thank you also for writing in the chat where you're watching us from. It is really very interesting to see where different people are joining us from. So with no more to do, let's get started. So what are we going to be doing in the session? Well, we're going to start with a brief overview of pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, and A2 flyers. Now, we appreciate that many of you may be quite familiar with these tests, but maybe not everyone in the audience. So we just have a little refresh over that and show how it relates to what we're going to talk about today. We will be, of course, exploring the statement of results, or sometimes it's called the SOR. And this, of course, is looking at how the results are given to your students. And it's not just about shields, as you will hear from Michael as we go through the session. Of course, we're going to talk about the personalized results. So how does that work? What can the learner do with these results? And what kind of ideas are given, especially for each individual candidate? And then throughout the session, we're going to be looking at ideas of how to use these, the statement of results, and also resources and other ideas to help you use assessment throughout the school year. So when we think about exams, often exams have a negative connotation. And there are lots of discussions about whether giving a young learner an exam is a good idea or not. But of course, exam skills are very important. But it's also very important that young learners have a positive experience, particularly at this stage in their learning journey. So of course, Cambridge exams for young learners, so pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, and A2 flyers, are designed to have a positive impact on learning and teaching. And we're going to be looking at how that works. But it's really important that we think about the principle of positive experiences and bringing the distance between a child's experience of what happens in the classroom and a child's experience of taking a test. And we'll look at that in more detail. So there are three tests, so pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, and A2 flyers, which are designed to take young learners from beginner level, let's say, to a basic user level at A2. Now, it's, as I said, it's this bridge between what happens in the classroom and what happens in the test. And one of the guiding principles for these tests is to make that distance as close as possible. So what they experience in the class is similar to what they experience in the test room. So we can see that in the materials. So we want this beginning experience, this fundamental first few levels, to help learners move forward to a positive learning experience and obviously improving their English competence as they move up the different levels, but starting with that confident start. So learning and assessment, of course, are very much connected. And of course, Cambridge University Press and Assessment, as our new name is now, is very much about linking learning assessment and using that positively to help learners learn English, improve their skills, and connect the classroom with the testing experience, particularly for young learners. So you can see that here in these examples of test materials. So these are taken from the Young Learner tests. And of course, what you immediately see is that they look very similar to the kind of material that you will find in a course book or that you will use in your classes. And of course, that's deliberate because the design of the tests is about that connection between learning and assessment. And if we just look at an example, so on the bottom right, you can see that this is taken from the speaking test of movers, and the students are going to find the differences between the two pictures. So the kind of activity they will be doing in class anyway, they also do in the exam. Again, just to say that these are the only exams that have colour material, and that again is related to the age of the students taking the tests and the fact that it makes that experience from the classroom and the test experience so much closer. Now, when we think about the actual tests, each of the three levels, of course, tests the four skills. It's very important in the sense that this will have an impact on both teaching and learning. And the fact that there are four skills means that teachers obviously will be thinking about practicing all the four skills in the content of their lessons. So they'll be including communicative activities, for example. And so learners are developing the skills, but they're also developing language skills that they will need to use English effectively also in the real world. So it's very much about that. And of course, the tests help you look at the measurement of your students' progress, and it's something that's reliable and consistent. And as you go up the three levels, you'll see that many of the tasks are similar, just a little bit more difficult, again, with that consistency between the levels. If we look at the physical layouts of the exams, there are obviously similarities between the levels. And of course, we have reading and writing tested together, and we have listening and speaking as separate papers. Now, the listening, you can see as the levels go up, actually, the time doesn't get much longer when you get to A2, because what changes, of course, is the level of difficulty, but also the speed of delivery gets a little bit faster as you go up the levels, of course. The speaking test, as you can see, gets a little bit longer, and each child will take the speaking test individually with an examiner. And the reading and writing, no surprises, of course, it gets a little bit longer as we go up the levels. Now, everything we're talking about today, you'll find information about in the Handbook for Teachers. So this is something you can download from the website, and it will give you the information we're talking about now and more to help you in your planning and in your working with your students. And you can also download two sample papers. Now, sample papers give examples of each of the parts of the paper that I've just mentioned. And of course, you can also download the audio as well, so that you have the audio to go with the listening parts of the test. And we're going to put QR codes throughout the session. So if you want to take a picture or link to the QR code, we hope you will find that useful. And also there will be some links sent to you, obviously, after the session. And I think if you keep your eye on the chat, you will also find some links in the chat too. So it's very much about the philosophy of looking at what learners can do. This is not about pass or fail. This is about rewarding students for what they can do with their different skills. And I don't know if you want to mention anything else, Michael, about that.
No, it's very, very important. And it starts from the basis of the whole examination, and the product is about giving young learners, giving our students the best possible start on their English journey. So it concentrates on constantly what the candidate can do, what you can do, and not what you can't do. And pass and fail really has no meaning in this test.
And of course, at young age, the foundations of taking a test will have an impact on what happens later. So it's really important that the learners are having a positive experience, particularly at this young age. So Michael was talking about what you can do. And of course, with the can-do statements from the Common European Framework obviously the tests are aligned to the Common European Framework. And so we have some examples here of can-do statements for each of the different levels. So looking at reading and writing and obviously listening and speaking. And these you can find in the handbook for teachers. And of course, you can see how they progress across the three levels. And that's also interesting for you to see the development of the skills as they move from pre-A1 to A2 flyers. So again, you can see these in the handbook, and you can see that they focus on different skills. And of course, they're very practical, and you can apply them to very practical activities in the classroom as well, as we will see as we go through. There's also a child-friendly set of can-do statements. Again, this is something you can download, and you can see for each level is a picture to go with that statement to obviously help it be more memorable perhaps, and also to give students an idea of where they're going, and they can think about what they can already do, and they can see about what they're going to be doing. And again, it's something that is good to share with your students. And if you're, it might be something you also discuss in the child's language and or in English, depending on your circumstances. But definitely something which is worth sharing also possibly with the parents as well. So again, we've got a QR code for you, and you will find this on the website. So the child-friendly can-do statements. So fundamentally, the Young Learner Tests are designed to help learning be fun. They're motivating because there's a sense of progression, and also obviously taking the test itself can be motivating as a kind of recognition of their learning. It's all about being positive. It's about encouraging learners to move forward and to be thinking, as we keep saying, about what they can do. Incredibly important. And of course, all the students will get a certificate. And this is just an example of a certificate. And you can see that the skills are reading, writing, listening, and speaking. And we'll talk about the shields in a moment. But just to say that one of the great things about young learners is that they are inclusive. Nobody is excluded, because every child will receive a certificate. And so this is just an example of a class who are enjoying the celebrating and receiving their certificates. And of course, that's something you might want to do with your students, is to celebrate together when they get their certificate. But as I said, everyone gets a certificate, which is very important. So the certificate looks like this, and on the back of the certificate, you'll find the can-do statements are there again. And again, this is about celebrating achievement, certifying the level of English, and again, helping confidence for our learners as they move through that learning journey. Now, I think Michael's going to give us a bit more detail about this. So, Michael.
Yes, for young learners, we thought it important not to concentrate on a score or a grade. This is the reason why we have shields, which indicate the level of ability that the candidate can do, has shown the ability that they can do this after the test. So this is the reason why we have the shields and the way that they're shown. And on the back of the certificate, then you can see what the shields mean. As well as at the bottom, you have the can-do statements from the Common European Framework. But the other thing about the shields is that the shields aren't a grade. They don't work like a grade. It depends on how the candidate has answered specific tasks within each test, so that each task has a different testing focus. And so it's how the candidate has addressed those particular tasks that indicate their ability with that testing focus, with that particular can-do statement. And so on that basis, then we awarded the shields. But also on the front, we also have some particular advice for the candidate as well. I'm going to go to the next slide. So this is like a zoom in to the top part of the certificate or the statement of results. And you can see here how the shields work in relation to the levels of the Common European Framework that are being tested via the different parts of the young learners testing product. So we have pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, and A2 flyers. And you can see here that if you have, for example, a strong candidate on movers who gets 5 shields, then that also would be equivalent to the flyers 3 shields because of the way that these have been graded, but also in the way that the reporting of the different skills is done, so that you might see a candidate who has 5 shields in reading, for example, but might only have 3 shields in listening. And as we can see from this particular example, then this candidate in the middle, the movers, then we can see that they have reading writing for 4 shields, but their listening is 3 shields. And so you can see on the chart there how the difference relates in their particular skills in those areas. And also it gives an indication of what that learner needs to build on in order to bring up their skills to the rest of into a more even profile. Now, on the front of the statement of results, it's not just about the shields. What you might not be aware of is that every candidate gets different advice. This is something new. We only started a couple of years ago. And if you want to know the kind of in-depth science behind how this works, there is another webinar that you can find on YouTube that was put together by a couple of my colleagues here in Cambridge. And you can see when this was introduced, the science behind it. I'm not going to go into all of that detail here today, but looking at the front of the statement of results, we have individual advice for each candidate. So that you might not think that this is, you might not be aware of this, but actually this is different for every candidate, and it is based on how they have answered the different parts of the test. At the top, it tells the candidate what they can do. So it's what you can do now. And so there's a list there. And again, these are slightly reworded from the can-do statements you might find on the back of the statement of results. And this is so that they're more understandable to the candidate and also their teachers and perhaps even their parents. In the middle, the things that they need to work on, things that they can, ideas about how they can improve their general ability. And at the bottom, again, these are the areas that they would need to improve on in order to bring their general level up. And so again, to point out, these are generated separately for each candidate. These are individual to the candidates, as we're going to show you.
Okay, so yes, and the idea of practical ideas of what they can do to improve, we'll come back to that as well. So continue with that then, Michael.
Yeah, so I mean, going back to what I was saying before about how the shields and the personalized feedback are generated, you can see here that based on the testing focus of the individual parts of the test and how the candidate has answered those parts, this is how the shields and also the individual advice and can-do statements are generated. So for example, looking at the chart we've got there, pre-A1 starters, the sub-skill we're looking at is understanding basic descriptions. And this is drawn from the read-write part 2 and the read-write part 4. And with movers, again, another example, using grammar and vocabulary knowledge accurately, this comes from the read-write part 4 and the listening part 1. So when people are asking us about how is this scored, how is it put together, there is no simple answer to that because there's an awful lot of research and a lot of things going on in the background, which really go to the heart of the design of the entire examination suite.
So continue for what you're saying, Michael, let's have a look at an example and just taking some of the statements here at the bottom. Let's have a look at some of the tasks and the sub-skills as Michael was talking about. So here we've got a task from starters, and we can see, of course, that the what the testing focus is and the sub-skills. So here we've got pictures and letters. And so, of course, in this part of the test, The child has to identify the name of the object or the animal in this case, and then write it out using the letters which are there. So scaffolding, there's still some scaffolding even in the test. So there's they use the letters to create the word. Now, of course, there is a subskill that we're testing here, which perhaps you'd like to write in the test. Oh, sorry, in the chat, what you think the subskill is being that's tested here. So if you can write in the chat. So what's the subskill? Let's see if we've got any answers. Yes, thank you. Some very fast writers there. So thank you. Absolutely. So we're actually, yes, there is a definite test of spelling. So if you like writing, but it's obviously supported, and particular with spelling, it's the subskill of spelling. Yeah, absolutely. So continuing that, for an information for teachers, in the handbook, you will find for each of the tasks, so like this one, you will find that there is information which will be useful for you as a teacher. First of all, it obviously for each one, it explains what the task is and what the learner needs to do. And it also gives what's the assessment. So what's actually being assessed here? And of course, we're looking at producing vocabulary at single level, item level in this particular task with support of visuals and scrambled letters. Now, one of the things that I find quite useful is to think about the assessment statement in the handbook as a way to change it into a can do. So in this particular case, we can say the learner can produce vocabulary at single item level, for example. So if you're thinking about the relationship with the can do, this is one way that you can also exploit that. Now, just so you know, in the handbook, if you haven't seen it, there's also a section for each of the tasks, which also gives you some ideas about how to approach the task. So, having thought about what the assessment focus is, there's also practical suggestions about how you might want to approach it. Let's just have a look at another example. Again, staying with starters, this time part one, the students are going to read and put a tick or a cross, having read the word, so they've got to recognize the word. So here we have, again, in the handbook for the teachers, we can see that we have the assessment focus, so the candidate's ability to recognize the meaning and then relating them to a visual. So we can say, and changing that into a can do, the candidate or the learner can recognize the meaning of a word. And in this case, relates them to a picture, so can recognize the meaning of a word. It's also interesting that this is also, if you like, exam skills training, because the students have to learn about ticks and cross. That's not necessarily the same in every culture, that a tick means yes and a cross means no. So again, we're also learning some basic exam skills along the way as well. So how can we use that feedback for further to support both learning and teaching? Well, of course, the first thing is to, as Michael has said, every learner is individual and their feedback will be individual, which is one is very positive aspect of this test feedback. And so as a teacher, we need to obviously look at the whole class and start to identify where there may be some similar statements that perhaps identify an area that all the class might benefit from having a look at. So taking an example of two students, so we have a student here who has got 3 shields in listening, 5 in reading and writing, speaking. Now this is quite a strong student. I'll just make it bigger so you can see the statements. So it's quite a strong student, and you can see that they've got lots of statements in what their strengths are. So very positive there for this particular candidate, and not so much in the suggestions and ways to improve, because it's if you like, a strong candidate here. Now we can compare that with another candidate who's actually got the same number of shields, but is slightly not quite as strong as the first candidate. So again, I'll make the statements bigger so you can see better. you will actually see that some of the statements are the same as the first candidate that we saw before. For example, the first sentence, you can read and understand some simple sentences and very short texts that use common English words. That was the same as the other candidate. And then you can understand some the last sentence, you can understand some very short, simple English conversations where people ask and answer questions, was the same as the other. But here you can see that this candidate has got slightly, so there are more statements about things they can work on and a couple of more ideas about what they can do to improve. So even though the shields are the same, the statements will not necessarily be so, for exactly the reasons that Michael was explaining, is their overall performance in different parts of the test will influence obviously the statements that are selected for that particular candidate. And we can see them here. You can see the difference just visually, that yes, the slightly weaker candidate has more statements here. So that's really following on from what Michael was saying, but you can see it's very practical and very positive. Of course, we need to be thinking about setting goals, and of course, part of teaching is setting the appropriate goals for our, you know, for the individual and for the class, and in giving feedback on how well the goals are achieved or how progress is being made. And also, if we think about a student who perhaps is moving from A1 starters to a pre-A1 starters to A1 movers, then, like as Michael said, perhaps where they had three shields might be an indication that that would be something to focus on a little bit more as we set the goals and that they move through the levels. So I've just got a couple of examples. So as a whole class, let's say we've identified that this particular statement is quite common for many of the students in the group. So practice understanding, very simple spoken descriptions, obviously practice understanding. So we're looking at listening, developing listening. We're also looking at the vocabulary areas of description of people and description of things. So we've got something there to work with. Now, we can actually also identify, as Michael was saying, where this is tested in the exam. So for example, in this case, part three, listening, we're going to be understanding simple descriptions, and we're going to be actually, this particular example, descriptions of people, and we can see they're actually going to be related to people. So as a teacher, we can decide, okay, I'd like to work on this particular area, and we can use, obviously the course book may give you a good basis to do this from, but you can also find some material that you can download from the website. So for each section of each test, there are lesson plans that you can download for free from the website, which help you focus on some aspect of the test. So this one is looking at description, and it gives you a description of what the lesson is like. And I'll just make it a bit bigger. And it takes you through different stages. And in this particular one, we're looking at understanding description. So we can break it down to looking at the vocabulary. And so I've taken this. This actually comes from the word list. And you can see the word list is also grouped according to topic. And there's also an alphabetical list, but there's also a topic list. And the topic list, of course, helps us focus on the vocabulary of people. And then, again, from the lesson plan, you can download the worksheet, and there's a word search activity. And of course, this is helping develop the vocabulary they're going to need for the task. And actually, I think, Michael, you once had something to say about word searches.
Word searches are a very good activity. They're fun. They're great for a warm-up. But also, they do have a serious point behind them. Not only are we practicing and learning the vocabulary in context according to the topic, because it's always important to teach vocabulary by the topic and not in just out of context completely. But also, research has shown us that the eye movements that we make when we're doing a word search are very similar to those that we need when we're doing reading for gist. And so it's an activity that I did when I was teaching young learners, but also when I was teaching IELTS preparation, because it was an excellent reading practice and reading skills practice for students at every level.
That's fantastic. Great. And then, of course, once we've done some preparation, the lesson plan will give you some more stages. Then, of course, you have the material and the audio to practice the task. If you were looking for this material, this is the place to find it on the website under the resources for teachers. And on the right-hand side, you can see select qualifications. So obviously that's where you would put A1 movers or A2 flyers. And of course, then you select the resource. I would put in lesson plan, and that would take you to the material. And if you put in the skill, then it would isolate the lesson plans, obviously related to that particular skill, like the one I've just shown you. And if we think about other materials that we could use, again, to stay with this topic, one, of course, is using the flashcards. Again, perhaps getting the students to listen to you describing one of the objects or the animals, and then they have to identify the one you're describing from the set of words. There are various flashcards that you can download, and obviously you can choose the topic that's related to the statement that you want to work on. So, for example, in this case, people and things. And I think, Michael, we were talking about flashcards earlier.
Yes, with flashcards, again, it's important to remember to teach vocabulary along a theme. So following the categories that you find in the word list, so that what you're doing in a real sense is you're not only just encouraging the candidate or the learner to learn and identify the different vocabulary forms from a picture, for example, but also what you're doing then is you're helping to build this cognitive framework which the learner will then need when they're going into a real life situation. So for example, we got a title here, favorite toy shop, and that toy shop then should trigger the vocabulary that the candidate has learned to do with toy shop. And so all of that stuff will be ready to be understood and also produced. Similarly with animals and going to the zoo, that kind of situation. So it's not just about real life situations, but also situations within the examination. So for example, when we're introducing a new task, which is on a particular theme, like going to the park, then as soon as the candidate can hear those words, going to the park, or read them, then that will trigger those memories and prepare that framework for understanding and language production.
Absolutely. Okay, so also focusing on the part of the statement that gives you ideas of what you can do to improve. So again, just taking an example, the student might be encouraged to find a picture, write a sentence about it, and even make a book. And then, of course, we can do the writing, focusing on vocabulary, but also getting the students to talk about their pictures and obviously practicing their speaking skills as well. There are lots of ideas, including, of course, looking at songs as another way to find improve and do activities. And again, we just want to highlight a resource that you might like to use. It's called Sing and Learn, and it's a video with song. And again, using the vocabulary related to the Young Learner tests, you can also download some notes and some learning activities related to that. So again, reinforcing listening, speaking, vocabulary, etc., related to ideas for improving for those students. So we've been thinking about the class. What about the individual learner? So of course, it's important for each student to look at their statement of results with you and see what ideas there are for what they can work on, how they might improve. And you might again suggest some resources that either use in class or that they learn also to use outside class, or possibly even to use with their parents, depending on the circumstances. But things like you can see, we talked about Sing and Learn, but there are also activities that you can use with specifically, for example, describing people, again, from the website. We can also get the students to actually focus on those strengths. So apart from reading them, but also thinking about writing them and thinking about what they can work on, what they can improve. And sometimes you may want to do this discussion in the student's own language. We appreciate it may not always be appropriate to do all of this in English. But it's the idea that they start to understand how they can, you know, what they're doing well and areas that they can use to get even better. And I think that's really important. It's not being about wrong, it's being about what can you do to improve. And I think that's what you can do and what you will be able to do. So things like that, we can use a template like this one, helping your students set some simple study goals, which might be, in this case, I could say 5 new words about my family. And then they plan to do that. And when they do it, of course, they can give themselves a tick, or they can actually say, I want to practice this more. And I think that's very important, that being able to say, I want to practice this more is okay. And it's very much part of the learning process. And we want to encourage that awareness that the student can practice a bit more. And again, if it's appropriate and you want to, you may want to involve the parents. This is a 30-day learning activity worksheet, which you can, again, download for free. And each day there is a little activity that the child can do. And they're also, some of them are interactive and they click through and do the activity. But again, it's a way of perhaps involving the students, but getting them to do something every day, a tiny little bit of English every day, may be, of course, beneficial. So that brings me to kind of bring together the idea of learning to learn. And I've taken a quote from Carol Reed's book here, that learning how to learn is a process that takes place over time. Children progressively develop self-awareness and willingness to take responsibility, but that needs to be nurtured, of course, by the teacher. And that's really important, that gradually, it's not going to happen immediately, that they begin to be able to manage, to monitor and to evaluate their progress, even as young learners. But obviously it needs scaffolding. And why we're doing it? We're doing it because, of course, it's important to develop that learner independence as students go up the levels and autonomy. We can start when they're young too. And there are lots of activities to do that we can use. This is from an activity card set that I'll show you at the end. Things, simple things. So whatever course book you're using, you can get them to be thinking, close the book. What do they remember about what they've learned? So even that process of consolidating the learning is really important and can have an important impact. And of course, we can get them to think about their own reactions and their attitudes to learning and find out how they're feeling about a particular activity. Is this something that they're feeling very comfortable with? Or maybe it's something that they will indicate that would be useful for them to do more work on. And we encourage them to think about what the experience was and explain their reasons. Again, you might be doing this in English and in their own language. Now, Michael, you had some comments about young learners doing these kind of tasks.
Well, yes. I mean, when I started my career in education, the idea that young learners would be able to take control of their own learning process in this way was looked at as very strange, as something that would never happen. But young learners really is a fantastic series of products. And a great curriculum to enable young learners to do exactly that, to learn these study skills and take control of their learning in a very real way, which will stand them in good stead when they go on and continue their English journey all the way through their education career.
Absolutely. And so that really fits in with the idea of developing metacognitive skills and learning strategies. So quoting from Carol Reed, that what does that really mean? Of course, it's about understanding what they're learning, why they're learning it, how they're learning is also an important part of this. And of course, subsequently, what they need to do. And we've been talking about the planning So absolutely, these are key areas that we can explore. So some of the practical things that teachers can do and do, I'm sure many of you have a course book that will state what's in the units and presenting that to the learners in a child-friendly way so that they can see what the learning objectives are in a very simple way. So in this case, you're focusing on vocabulary of the family, they're looking at writing and speaking, but they can see what they're going to be doing in the unit, helps them understand better, hopefully will enhance engagement, and ultimately the idea is, of course, to make learning more effective if the learners are involved more in the process. Some of you will be familiar with KWL charts. I'm sure you use those. What do you know about a topic maybe before you start? What would you like to know? And what did you learn after you've done the activity, of course? And then there's a fourth question I think is useful to ask, which is also, how did I learn it? Because this is, of course, encouraging students to think about learning strategies. And we want to help our learners to have a wide repertoire of strategies so that I think we need to encourage them to explore different ways of doing things, because if they always do it the same way, they may not discover that maybe if they did it in a different way, it might actually be more effective for them. So for example, a learner might not never have tried recording themselves saying some words that they've learned, for example, or using a sentence, making a sentence using these words. They might not have thought about doing that. But again, if we ask them to think about how they're learning, they can also start to be more aware of what helps them with their learning. So again, the idea of getting to do it in different ways, so saying and writing and seeing what the goals are in the unit, but also thinking about the outcomes as well. So doing it in different ways, so we can just see on this page how we might do it in a slightly different way. But also we need to be thinking about reflection and evaluation at simple level and how they monitor their progress. We need to scaffold this very much and to provide simple feedback, simple tools, which can be as simple as something like measuring progress. Now, progress is not about level or achievement, but it's have I done it? How much have I done? Which everyone can do. So again, monitoring their own progress is a small part of that reflection and of evaluation of their progress. So again, these are downloadable sheets, worksheets that you can get from the website. We also need to encourage very simple self-assessment. Was it fun? Ask after a task or an activity, not always at the end of the unit, but even at a task level, to ask themselves some questions, and also giving them simple checklists so they're aware of what they're achieving. And of course, if you're giving them the objectives at the beginning, then it's important to remember to go back and say, okay, let's have a look at the end. What did we achieve? And also, it's an opportunity to review the vocabulary covered in that unit, but also to get them to think about their experience of that learning. And again, encouraging them, I'm going to try again. It's okay to say that if they're going to improve their learning, and think about their favorite things as well. More activity cards. This one encourages students to actually say, okay, I've had some feedback. Next time I will. Maybe I need to practice whatever. And so again, it's very simple feedback, but again, it's getting students more engaged in what they're doing. Now that brings us back to looking at the can-do statements. And of course we can take those can-do statements for the handbook and individually monitor how students are progressing. And if you like, this is very much about formative assessment. We're using criterion referenced statements that we can use to help have a plan, to help think about different aspects of learning as a teacher as well as a learner, and to go beyond just discrete linguistic items or just a skill. So by having these, so we can observe. So it doesn't have to be stressful. It can be observing the child doing a classroom activity, and we can record their progress, refer to the can-do statements on different aspects of their learning. So again, it might be something you would like to try out. That brings us nearly to the end, but before we stop, we wanted to just mention a few more resources for you to take away. One is that we have mentioned the word list, so just so you know, you can download the word list. In the handbook, you will get the alphabetical word list, but in the word list, you get the alphabetical, and you also get the topic-based vocabulary list that Michael was mentioning. It was very important to think about the topic, and this is where you will also find those. We also have flashcards related to some of those topics that you, again, you can download. There are also some activities which can be downloaded related to the flashcards. So again, very practical activities. And the word lists also have some picture books, which have a few of the topics, not all of the topics, in those word lists and picture books. And the progress charts that I showed you earlier actually are reference to these picture books. So again, if you're wanting to use that, you can obviously combine the two things together. So also to bring to your attention is the World of Better Learning blog. There are lots and lots of materials in here, lots of practical activities. We've just chosen one article, obviously, from the blog about this topic, which you might want to follow up on after the session. Also in the blog, you'll find practical ideas, including a little primary podcast with ideas and tips for teaching learners, young learners. So you might want to explore those resources as well. And we also mentioned learning to learn. It's part of the Cambridge Life Competences framework. And there is lots of information about that. There is also going to be a session in a future webinar about life competences. But just to mention that the learning to learn leaflet for this part of the framework is downloadable. And also, and there's the QR code for you to make it easier. And also I was using the activity cards from the set that is related to the language competences framework. So I think that brings us to the end of the session, in the sense that we've had a brief overview of the three levels of the Young Learner tests. We've been exploring the statement of results, or the SORs, and looking at the information as well as the shields, and the fact that results are personalized for each individual learner, with some ideas and suggestions for each one of them. And throughout, we've been trying to provide you some ideas and some resources to support your work as you go throughout the year. So I think that brings us to the end. So have we got time for questions? Oh, this one. We need to ask you if it was useful. Practice what we preach. Isn't it, Michael? So there's a little thought for you. Was it useful? And what are your takeaways? And if you'd like to write in the chat any comments, that would be great. And now, then we'll answer your questions as well.
Yeah, I'll look at the questions.
you've found the questions?
Yes. From Nanda, we have a question. Would you please share some advice in balancing classroom flows and how to assess the students if there is a gap regarding students' ability? Thank you so much. So I think what Nanda's talking about there is a multi-level class, which obviously can be quite problematic, especially for us, it seems. Have you got any good tips on how do you handle a multi-level class, Sarah?
Well, I think this is the idea of having some overall aims for everyone, and then some personalized aims, as in fact the statement of results encourage. But yes, it's always a challenge. I think the fact that there are lots of different materials, so you can perhaps give a task with different levels within that task, is of course a challenge for all of us, but that's probably the best way. Would you say so?
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Another idea is what we call close peer guidance and close peer feedback. You might have students that are as you can see from your statement of results, that have strengths in some areas which correspond to the weaknesses of other students. And so why not get them to work together so that you have reinforcement for the student that already has that can-do ability and the necessary practice and help and model of the close peer for the weaker student.
Absolutely. Let's see what other questions we can answer. Thank you for the feedback about setting goals is important. That's great. Can you see any other questions?
Oh, I've got one here from Colin. Why are most word search sheets all in caps? Shouldn't it be in small caps? Because kids will be reading small caps most of the time. I think I'm not sure really. It depends on how it's put together. When I was teaching, I used to use an online resource where you could set the parameters of the word search test yourself. You could put in your own word list. You could sort out the size of the word list and also the font. And if there was any graphics you wanted to put in, you could put those in too. I'm sure that there are resources out there now which are very similar, if not better, to that. So you would have some control over that. But I think if you look around at different resources, I don't think you'll find that they're all caps.
Yeah. Okay, let's see if there's anything else that we can answer. Okay, the young learner tests haven't changed recently. So the material that we've been showing you is obviously up to date. There are new course books available and preparation resources, which you can find from Cambridge University Press if you're looking for support materials that are very new. And there's plenty of resources in the lesson plans that we showed you earlier. There's also information for candidates, because we were asking how can we follow up on tips to improve. There's also information for candidates, which you can share with parents, which you can also download, which talks about each part of the test as well. Anything else?
There are some quite technical questions. There's one from Sirhi. I apologize if I've mispronounced your name. What is the correlation between accuracy and fluency in the process of intercommunication? I mean, what is more important, especially during online classes when internet is not as reliable as it's supposed to be, and how to ease this procedure of mutual misunderstanding? Have you got any good tips for online classes, Sarah?
Well, my tips are that with young learners, it's about encouraging them to be successful. So we do need to be thinking about fluency and what they can do. And of course, having short activities, and the teacher needs to be very clear in their instructions and checking that their instructions have been understood by the learners, particularly if you're online. Would you agree with that, Michael?
Yes, absolutely. I think the idea of having very short and immediate tasks in that situation, I think, is a very good idea. accuracy and fluency. I think fluency is always something that we're headed towards. And as far as if we're talking about how we assess speaking at young learners and also going up through key as well, then what we're consistently looking for is the communication. Can the learner communicate effectively? So accuracy really is not that much of a problem at this stage. What we're looking for is, can they get across what they want to communicate? If they can do that, and if there are mistakes in it, that's fine. Because we don't really want to think about too much accuracy at this stage. We're thinking about that will to communicate. We want to encourage the learner to have that real will to communicate. And this is the reason why our materials, especially with speaking, are designed in this way, to create that kind of, give the candidate something that they want to tell, a story they want to tell.
Absolutely. Now, I'm afraid I think we've run out of time. It leaves me to say thank you very much indeed for joining us today. We hope it was useful, and we look forward to seeing you in another webinar. So thank you again.